to you all. Greetings from the Basque Country, from San Sebastian. My name is Sasha Correa. I am a journalist and I have been working in gastronomy for years. And I'm joining this session today from the Basque Culinary Center. And in these troubling but stimulating times, I would like to start by talking about habits. Do you know how long it takes to form a new habit? Actually, not that long, around 60 days. So we might just need around 8 weeks for something new or different to become ingrained in our life, or just the opposite, around 8 weeks to break a habit. We are not set in stones. Our behaviors or ways of thinking and acting can move in different directions. Sometimes we impose a habit on ourselves, but it doesn't work, as we know, because our brain is hardwired to take shortcuts, so we do what comes naturally to us. Around 40% of what we do is connected with habits, with that second nature that just comes naturally. And it is a consequence of motivation, ability, trigger, and I would also add context. We're seeing it play out with this pandemic. It may be a state of an emergency, but it is also a context of interesting changes. When I see, for example, how all over the world, there are people cooking and rejecting this preconceived idea that cooking takes too much effort, time, or thinking, I get really excited. Recent surveys suggest that more than 50% of people are cooking more and even enjoying it much. So cooking at home for more than 60 days has come with important transformations. Not only are we realizing the true value of food, but we are recovering the forgotten power of being able to feed ourselves from our own hands. And it doesn't matter what we cook. Homemade French fries will always be healthier than the frozen ones we buy at the supermarket. With this in mind, from the perspective of a consumer at least, or someone who has always loved food but never actually cooked much, I think about the idea of a post-corona generation, made by those who got the chance to break a spell and see that cooking was possible and that it gives pleasure. At the beginning of the quarantine, we started cooking things that gave us comfort, like pasta or simple stuffs. But then we jumped to lentils, chickpeas, to see if we were able to cook what we thought only our grandmothers could. But then we took bigger challenges, and some even dared to make great bread from scratch, sign, by the way, of being around the fifth week of quarantine. We've had everything we needed, motivation, triggers, but then time, space, having to tour to local stores for basic ingredients and help. Chefs from all over have come to social media to give us a hand, as well as some cooking tutorials, books, and you name it. This cannot simply fade away. The habit could stay around after we saw what come with exploring and learning this much. Cooking has not only been a way to nurture our bodies, but a way to travel through food in moments of lockdown and social distancing, a way to connect with memories, with family, friends, and even a way to keep our minds together. This cannot simply fade away, right? It shouldn't. The habit could stay around after we saw what come with exploring and learning this much. It simply cannot disappear. Cooking was not only a way to nurture our bodies, but a way to travel through flavors in moments of lockdown and social distancing, a way to connect with memories, with families, with friends, and it was even a way to keep our minds together. On the other hand, the post-corona generation could try to break other spells as well. This pandemic is also an opportunity to start rethinking behaviors or reshaping our industry. I'm lucky to work at the Basque Culinary Center, surrounded by young people and amazing professionals. For years, we have been educating students into an interdisciplinary approach to gastronomy, showing how wide the spectrum of chefs actually is and promoting the implication of the people we graduate in much more than cooking. For us, and more than ever, it is important to think on chefs as more than professionals able to cook and feed others, It is clear they play a key economic and social role on society. From here, I have been speaking with all sorts of cooks during these weeks, with small producers, entrepreneurs, youngsters, and other devoted people of this big cause that we call gastronomy. In the same way many are desperate to get back to work and restart our normal life, we all know that the challenge, in fact, is much bigger than simply pressing play again after these lockdowns are over. You know why? First, because the virus is here and its presence directly complicates things for our industry. To start with, there is no way to eat or drink in bars or restaurants with a mask on. And we still need to figure what will happen to behaviors as we normally go to restaurants, not to be contained, but the opposite, to relax and enjoy. So the immediate new normal is quite difficult for our industry as we try to avoid the spread of the virus. Second, because although we are supposed to be on a pause, and this session is called an industry pause, we haven't been on a pause for a second. I see instead an effervescent time of crisis in which everything has been shaken and moved like on an earthquake. Imagine for a moment that you have a shelf for books on your wall. You put so many books and so many different things. You see that it starts to bend and then it cracks. You don't fix it. You only take some books out. You know that it's broken, but it is fine. Maybe later. You still have time to do something about it. But then a tremor comes, and this actually happened to me while I was living in Mexico. It tremors all the time. So everything crashes down to the floor. The shelf falls over the TV breaks, the books get smashed, and the glass of wine that you left there for some days spilled all over the pages and covers, and there you have it. There's a big mess. Given the opportunity to put your books back onto the wall, will you put back the broken shelf exactly as it was, as if nothing happened? We can only move forward. So for me, pressing the play button comes with great responsibility. Having more than 60 days to see things for what they are, I think, put us all in a demanding situation with no past to blame for the models that we take with ourselves into the future. In times of global crisis, global consciousness is also possible. Those who work in the guts of this industry know something that was already fragile just broke. Will the post-corona generation establish, now that we can, a different kitchen culture? Will we redefine business models now that we see the consequence of operating restaurants on systems that keep them just 1 month away from being in deep economic trouble? Will it still be okay to move with no social healthcare in countries like the US or so many others? What about fine dining and the way it assumed that it was okay to depend on tourism as much as to have 80% of customers from abroad as normal? How about the impact on daily lives of chefs' endless hours of work with no time for normal life and sometimes with excessive traveling or exposure? It has been pretty moving to see chefs reconnecting with themselves, but also and mostly with their local public, decentralizing the way restaurants normally operate and trying the unthinkable to keep operations working, to maintain their staff, to see even 3 Michelin star chefs cooking brisket or whatever it takes, showing how much actually can be done to share with people affordable, delicious food. Also, it has been inspiring to see so many people getting involved in solidarity initiatives or just focusing on what it is really important, exploring honest ways to give value to food and to our industry. Pause? We're definitely not in a pause. Now that restaurants will reopen and that everyone will work as hard as ever to recover, we need to ask ourselves, how will we be able to assure decent working conditions without doubling endless hours to recover economically with half of the staff? Or without simply doubling the amount of stagiaires to compensate? Will we rebuild our teams keeping the same gender imbalance as it could still be okay or whatever? Will we take the chance to improve salaries or the basics of team management to better conditions than the ones inherent from the past? Will cooking school prepare the students with more than culinary training? For us at Basque Culinary Center, it has been clear from the beginning that students should master not only culinary talents, but all the work and skill that comes with business management. This couldn't be more obvious now. The future is definitely not getting any greener, and climate change should not be forgotten under this big topic. Of course, I don't have the answers, and also I'm not as naive as to think that we can change the world in 60 days. As said, our brain will always look for shortcuts to go back to what comes naturally to us. I only know that we have a lifetime opportunity to find different solutions to problems than the ones that brought us to this point and exposed our industry so much under this pandemic. For that, I believe in the ability, talent, strength, and creativity of this industry. It is obvious creativity and innovation are needed more than ever. I trust we can transform ideas into habits and habits into new models and models into new ways of functioning, prioritizing, and connecting ourselves. As in fact, it is happening with something as little and as big as home cooking. Now that we are on our 8th week of quarantine, that we've mastered chickpea stews, sourdough bread, or even paella, are we ready to cook the transformations that we need? If it takes around 60 days to form a new habit or break a spell, where will we start?